Good morning. Well, I know we have one announcement, so we'll let George come on up. And if anyone else has any, please raise your hand.
Good morning. The announcement I have is Daniel's taking vacation August 14th. We're looking for a lay reader who may want to do the sermon. You don't have to put together the entire bulletin if you're not comfortable with that. Some people are. But if you have an interest in it, please let myself or Paulette or any of the other deacons know. Thank you. The other thing, there's been a request since we've had a few guests on occasions that maybe we start wearing our name tags. So if you don't have one, let one of the deacons know and we'll get them updated. Thank you.
All right. Well, my name is John Mazzei, and as a member of the Board of Deacons of our church, I want to welcome you to this morning's worship service. Now, please allow the lighting of the altar candles and the ringing of the bell to invite you into silent prayer and meditation as we prepare ourselves to worship our God. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. At this time, we're going to have the call to worship, so please stand. Lord, help us to read your word. Lord, help us to love your word. Lord, help us to revere your word. At this time, please remain standing for the gathering hymn, Stand Up and Bless the Lord, number 25. Thank you. Father God, we invite you into this service today. Be with us and fill us with your Holy Spirit as we come together to worship you. Help us to have a deeper appreciation for the love letter you have written to us in the form of your holy word, the Bible. And we read the Lord's Prayer together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus came into this world so that we could be forgiven for our sins. Let us confess them now freely. Father, we confess our sins this morning. Right now, we especially focus on the way you've treated your word, that we've been too casual with it, that we haven't soaked in your word, that we haven't revered it properly and given it the high esteem we should. A new heart, a generous spirit, a fresh start are the gifts God gives to us. So I haven't let you sit down yet, so I apologize for that. Please remain standing for the Gloria Patri. Time with the children come up for the children's message. Okay, it's because they have interesting stories and they help you need to learn.
Rachel, is that right? What's that? Say it again.
The way to pass the time? Okay, great, because you know a lot of kids are playing video games and shooting up people. Nevin? Ah, reading is good because it makes you learn new things. All right, excellent. So, tell me, have any of you heard of this book? Okay, what's it called? The Bible. All right, excellent, right? Now, who can tell me who wrote that book? Say that again. God or Jesus? Yeah, God wrote the book, yeah. And there's four Gospels in the New Testament, which is really about Jesus, right? And the Gospels all talk about what Jesus did, and you know, you even have words that Jesus said to us. All right, very good. So what if I told you that God himself wrote this book as a special love letter just for you? Would you believe it? All right, praise the Lord. So now can you tell me why reading this book is important? Well, wait, one at a time. I'm glad that you're eager, but go ahead, Teresa. God and Jesus were alive and what happened back then. Okay. And you know, God is still alive, right? All right. And Jesus is still alive, but he's up in heaven. Rachel? Excellent. It teaches you what God and Jesus did, right? And so that we can learn about that. And Nevin? Okay, I'll buy that. So as I'm going to tell your parents in the sermon today, there are many important reasons to read this book. Can you name a few? I guess you just have. You might have thought of some, if you can think of some other reasons to read this book, you might have thought of some that I didn't write down in my sermon, but the mothers and fathers will have to forgive me if I missed any. Okay, so can you tell me any other reasons to read the Bible? Excellent, excellent. So you will know how to do the right thing. I got that one. Rachel? Teach you to pray? Oh, excellent. I didn't get that one. Oops. I teach you to pray. Excellent. Nevin? Okay. So when it comes right down to it, the most important reason to read the Bible is it tells us how to please God. And, teaching us to pray is one of those. And it promises that Jesus came down from heaven so that we could be forgiven for our sins. That is, the book is all about love and forgiveness. The love that God has for us that was so great, it allowed him to send down himself in the form of his son to take on our punishment on the cross so that we could be forgiven for our sins. Can I get an amen, young men and women of God? All right, you can go back to your seats. Thank you. Give them a hand, everybody. At this time, we're going to have the passing of the peace. And if you're worried about COVID, just raise your hand and stand up. And if you're not so worried, you can do whatever you like. And this time we'll have a hymn, and you can remain seated for this one. Break Thou the Bread of Life, number 254. This time we'll have the sharing of joys and concerns. We're going to use the microphone. George will hand it out to you. And that's not only so I can hear, but also anybody watching on Zoom.
I'd like prayers for my sister who's undergoing some surgery on Wednesday, just that she has a safe surgery and comes out of it fine. Linda Amen. Is her name.
What's her name again?
Linda. Linda. Continue prayers for my dad who started the chemo and he's got through 1 week, 11 weeks to go. And also prayers for guidance for Liz and I as we search through all the different possible medications and stuff for her diagnosis that she got diagnosed with MS. So.
Prayers for Joanne Reitz. She's dealing with COVID right now. So prayers be with her.
Thank you so much for the prayers for my mother, Shirley. Just ask that you keep them coming. They are being answered. Yesterday, we found someone to sit with her and be with her for at least 8 hours a day, which is a real blessing and certainly a step in the right direction for us. So thank you.
I have one prayer. Amanda, my daughter, her boyfriend, who's been stationed in Syria, I believe left Syria yesterday, and safe travels on his way home.
Amen. I'd like everybody to extend your hands over to Liz right now. Let's ask for a special prayer for her. Lord, in Jesus' name, we ask you right now, Lord, to comfort and keep Liz Minor. Help her, Lord, to know that you have the last word regarding her MS, Lord. And we ask you, Lord, just to give her peace of mind. And help her, Lord, to battle through this disease. In Jesus' name, we know that you're a healer. Let us pray. Amen. We thank, we ask God for a blessing for Paulette's sister Linda as she goes through surgery on Wednesday. We thank God that Jan is doing so well and looking so spiffy with his tie today. He has outdressed the pastor, which is a no-no, but yeah, I guess he didn't get the memo. And we just thank God for him. Lord, we ask a blessing for Joanne Reese, who is suffering from COVID, but is doing better. Last time I talked to her, she's got some exhaustion, but not going to the hospital or anything drastic. So thank God for that. We ask blessings continued for Dave's mother, Shirley. We thank God that she's found somebody to sit with her for 8 hours a day. And we ask for a prayer for George's daughter, Amanda's boyfriend, who left Syria. And we ask for safe travels for him. And Lord, we ask you also to bless everybody who had prayers in their mind and on their heart that didn't mention them today. We know, Lord, that you answer prayer. And we thank you, Lord, for being a God who knows all, has all power, and will be with us even in our most difficult times. Amen. At this time, we're going to have the invitation to generosity.
To the end is love.
this time in a round of our solidarity.
Good morning. Our scripture reading is from the book of Joshua, chapter 1, verse 8. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. You shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to act in accordance with all that is written in it. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall be successful. Blessed are these words.
Good morning again. It's so good to see all of you. I know I hear that everything settles down in the summer, but we're not doing bad. Give yourselves a hand for making it out. And, you know, it's really good to see everybody, especially in their bright colors. George is doing an excellent job of showing us that he's ready for vacation. So I also want to make an announcement that yesterday I became a grandfather for the second time, as Miracle now has a little baby sister who was born, and her name is Serenity India Reed. And my wife has pictures if you want to look at them. Let us pray. Giving honor to God, who is the head of my life, to all of you who came out to hear a word from the Lord today. Lord, we ask you to bless this sermon, pour down your wisdom from heaven, remove everything that is in Daniel, and let your spirit shine through. Bless the ears that hear it. In Jesus' name, amen. As we just heard, Joshua 1 and 8 states, "This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. You shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to act in accordance with all that is written in it, and then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall be successful." Today, I'd like to talk to you about the benefits of meditating on God's word. That is, the benefits of reading the Bible and thinking about what it says to you. First, as we discussed last week, it builds our faith by letting us know we have the victory, both here and in the afterlife. As those of you who were here last week will recall, I mentioned that the Bible was full of stories about God giving folks the victory right here and now on this earth. While there are many examples of this theme in Scripture, I pointed to God parting the Red Sea for Moses and the people of Israel, and then drowning Pharaoh's army after the Israelites passed through on dry land. I also pointed out how God gave Moses' successor, Joshua, victory over the various peoples that inhabited Israel before Joshua and the Israelites conquered them and took over the land. I also quoted Psalm 27, verse 13, which says, "I had fainted unless I had believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I went on to point out the second way God gives us the victory, which is our eternal reward in heaven. Here I quoted Luke chapter 6, verse 23, which states, "Rejoice ye in that day and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven." Finally, I quoted Daniel 2, 44, which reads, "And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom, which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever." This scripture, I then pointed out, assures us that after Jesus comes back the second time, the world as we know it will be transformed into a place of perfect peace and love, a world that will stand eternally. Can I get an amen, church? Amen. But letting us know we have the victory both here and in the afterlife is only the first of many benefits of meditating on God's word. Now I'd like to spend the rest of my sermon listing the other ways God gave me. Although I'm sure there are more, as Rachel reminded us, that prayer is learning how to pray is one that I forgot. God gave me 10 specific ways that meditating on God's word blesses us. And while I'm going to touch on each one briefly today, I plan to go into each of them in more depth in future sermons, God willing. The second benefit of meditating on the Bible is that it builds our capacity to wait on the Lord. That is, it builds patience. Psalm 27 and 14 reads, "Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord." Today we live in a world where we are constantly rushing. The catchphrase today seems to be, "America runs on Dunkin'." Reading the Word of God grounds us in a way that allows us to relax and wait on God's timing. For God's timing is not ours, and he has infinite patience, something not all of us have. Am I right, church? A third benefit of meditating on God's word is that it makes us better people by showing us how to live righteously. 2 Timothy 3, 16 and 17 states that, quote, "All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be competent, equipped for every good work," end quote. The Bible encourages us to live righteously. In fact, as many of you know, Psalm 23 tells us that he leads us in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. That is, God wants us to live righteously, not only because he wants us to do what's right by our fellow men and women, but because we represent him as well. And of course, the Bible tells us that living righteously will be rewarded, both on this earth and in the life to come. One of the great things about living righteously, and I would know as someone who, like all of you, has lived righteously at times and at other times not so much, is the supernatural peace that comes from living right. This leads us to the fourth reason to meditate on God's word. That is that meditating on God's word gives us a supernatural confidence. Looking again at 2 Timothy 3 and 16, it says that all scripture is, quote, breathed out by God. You see, church, the Bible isn't just some book like any other. It is the work of approximately 40 men who were inspired by the Holy Ghost to write a love letter to us from God himself. And reading the word, particularly spending time reading the word and meditating on its meaning, is spending quality time with God himself. In Matthew chapter 4, verse 4, Jesus states, quote, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God." The Bible provides spiritual sustenance. That is, it fills us up spiritually the way food fills us up physically. The more you read God's word, the more a supernatural peace wells up inside of you. As Psalm 119, 165 states, great peace have those who love your law, and nothing can make them stumble. The fifth benefit of reading God's word is that it helps us to know God. While one can come to know God through many different avenues, including prayer and marveling at God's creation, either by focusing on the beauty of nature or contemplating the magnificence of the universe, reading the Bible is essential. The Bible is God's word to us, and Jesus himself was actually called the Word in the first verse of the Gospel of John, which reads, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." As we read God's word to get to know God's character, this is especially true, as we read God's word, we get to know God's character. This is especially true of reading the four Gospels, where we get to see what God did and said as he appeared to us in the human form of his son, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. This leads us to the sixth benefit, which is that reading the word of God develops and improves our relationship with God. Proverbs 8 and 17 states, "I love those who love me, and those who seek me find me." God loves those who love him, and those who seek him will find him. While there are many ways to find God, Scripture is one of the very best. Getting to know God Almighty through the Old Testament and God the Son through the New Testament helps us to have a relationship with him. To know God is to love God, and to know God's ways, we have to read God's word, period. Matthew 22, 37 through 40 states the two laws of love on which the whole Bible stands. As Jesus tells us that all the laws and the prophets boil down to loving God and loving our neighbor, that is everybody, as we love ourselves. This leads us to the seventh benefit of meditating on the word of God. It improves our relationship with our fellow men and women. This includes not only those we love, but those we consider our, quote, enemies as well. Proverbs 16 and 7 states that, quote, "When a man's ways please the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him." A man or woman who reads the Bible will not only get the knowledge of how to deal with other people, they will have the love and patience with which to do so. Having been fed both head knowledge and been given that peace that passeth all understanding, they will be so at peace with themselves that they won't be irritated or threatened by someone else's bad behavior. They will ask themselves, "How can I help this man or woman?" instead of, "How the heck do I get rid of them?" Can I get an amen, somebody? This leads us to the eighth benefit of reading God's word, which is that it helps us to witness to others. Today's scripture, Joshua 1 and 8, opens with the line, "This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth." That is, that we shall speak what it says. And what it says is that we should share our faith with others. The Great Commission at the end of the book of Matthew states, quote, in part, "Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." As if all this wasn't enough reason to get into God's word, the ninth reason to read his word is that it helps us to prosper. Can I get an amen, somebody? The first three verses of Psalm 1 state, "Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper." This prosperity can be financially, spiritually, mentally, and emotionally. For God's word provides a blueprint for success. Going back to our featured text, Joshua 1 and 8 states, This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. You shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to act in accordance with all that is written in it. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall be successful. Furthermore, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 tells us to trust in the Lord with all our heart and to lean not to our own understanding, in all our ways to acknowledge him, and he shall direct our paths. You see, my brothers, my sisters, you who are in this sanctuary and you who are watching this online are not listening to these words haphazardly. God has led you to this sermon, and he wants you to know that he has ordered your steps and has put you on the path so that he might encourage you to read his word. And here I am a witness. This week I spent more time than I normally do in God's word, and the attacks of the enemy, attacks of worry and fearfulness that I suffered the week before, did not affect me at all. Instead, every time the enemy came at me with a negative thought, it fell off me like water off a duck's back, and I have been given a supernatural peace, the kind of peace that comes with spending quality time with God. This brings us back to square one. That is, when we meditate on God's word, we get the most important benefit of all, the one that blesses our soul and is the one overriding message of the Bible as a whole, which is that God loves us and that he loves us so much he was willing to come down in the form of Jesus Christ, his only begotten son. And not only that, but he was willing to let himself as Christ go to the cross and take on all sin for you and I so that we will have the victory. As John 3 and 16 states, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Can I get my final amen, church? Amen. Right now, there might be one who does not know Christ, or one who feels they have backslidden and want to reestablish their relationship with God. Whether that's someone here in the sanctuary or someone watching the service online, I want you to know that Jesus is waiting, that God loves you. If you feel called to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior today, just repeat after me. Lord, I am a sinner in need of salvation. I turn my life over to you. I believe you are the Son of God and that you died on a cross for my sins and that you were raised again on the third day, conquering death and hell. If that was you and you're here in the sanctuary, I ask you to speak with me after service. Finally, if there's anyone here who does not have a church home and wants to join this body of believers, if that's you, I ask you to speak with one of the deacons after church service is over. God bless you all. And at this time, please stand for the closing hymn, On Eagle's Wings, coming from the supplemental hymnal, The White Book, number 74. that? Lord, we thank you for this sermon today. And we ask, Lord, that as we go to our separate homes, that we will read your word and gain the perfect peace that comes from it. Lord, your word is a love letter to us, and help us, Lord, to remember that as we go through our days. Bless us, Lord, even as we go to our workplaces and in our homes. Bless us with peace, Lord. Heal those who are sick and give us comfort. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.